Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Human Desire Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes how God's laws respond to human desire and gives examples of how these human desire principles are built into God's laws and act upon all matter according to the human soul's current faith. Recorded on the 25th of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay, so now we come to the human desire principles. And what we're going to do here is introduce the human desire principles and compare them with the human will principles, so that we can fully understand how to actually change. Because unless you get this, you will never change. That's the reality. So let's have a look at it. What is human desire? Let's look at the terminology we're using. It's the genuine expression of current soul-based faith. So here we put it here, we put desire. And here, remember, we said that will was our current soul-based condition. So here it's condition. And it's the current condition. And here, desire is our current faith. Interesting, isn't it? Our current faith. Now, of course, it can only occur in self-aware beings. It's measured by its relative harmony with God's principles. Of course, both things are measured by their relative harmony with God's principles. But they're measured differently in the sense that one thing is measured, and both things are being measured simultaneously by the laws, by the way. So this means that right at this moment you have a certain will, which is your current condition, that's being measured by the laws. And right at this moment, you have a certain set of desires, and that's also being measured by the laws. That makes sense? And there's a different response. If one is different to the other on the same subject, there'll be a different response. All right, so that's interesting. So it's expressed as an intended or aspired to soul-based emotional state. In other words, you have faith in a new state on that issue, whatever the issue is. So let's say you look at your... So we're still measuring things like your passions. I'll do this in blue again. Still measuring this things by your passions and your addictions even. Still the same things that you're measuring, but it's an aspired to state for your future. What are you hoping for the future? So it's your current faith, and faith is an aspired to state for the future. So it's actually where your current faith is. Your faith determines what you currently believe your future is possible of having. Does that make sense? So desire is driven by what the soul currently has faith in. So desire is driven by what the soul has faith in. Now, perhaps we can give an illustration that might make some sense in comparison to these two things. So let's say at the moment, your current will is that you are living in a state where you, in your heart, believe, and it's an attitude or belief system that you have, that doing a good deed is going to get punished. So this causes you to actually, right at this moment, believe that you should not do anything or just do what the world accepts as good. Right? Because you believe that if you do what God thinks is good, you will get punished. That's what you believe, right? And so your current will is going, I'm going to do that because that I feel I'm not going to get punished for that. I'll do that because I'm not going to get punished for that. So can you see what's driving you? It's really fear driving your choices and decisions, is it not? But it's automatic. You just automatically do it. You go ahead and do it. Bang, done. Bang, done. You don't even have to try. You're just in the automatic mode, just doing one thing after another, because your soul condition is saying, if you do something good, you'll get punished. So you're better off not doing anything so-called good from God's perspective. You're better off just fitting in with the world or not doing anything at all. Does that make sense? And this is how many of you actually are when you hear divine truth. You actually feel it's better to not do anything at all. You can listen, but not do, because you might get punished for doing, right? So this is a belief that many of you have. Now, what is your faith about it at the moment? Well, for the majority of you, you believe with your whole heart that that state is true, that you will get punished if you do something in harmony with God's way of doing it. You believe you will get punished. So at the moment, your desire matches your will on that issue. So let's do the example in red. So my will is saying good, and I'm using the term good from God's perspective, deeds are punished. That's the current will condition. That's the feeling you have inside of your will. You follow? But at the moment, it's also the feeling you have in your desire. Good deeds are punished. And so this now causes you to not do anything good, because you have a definite faith in the future that if you do something good, you will get punished. That's your faith. You believe with your whole heart and you have faith in the fact that you will get punished. So that's why you don't do anything good. Even though you know what good from God's perspective is, there's still a desire to not do it. Right? Now, how does that change? Now, can you see, I only need a few minor shifts for that to change in my desire. My desire could go, experiment. With this belief. That could be my desire. All right? Now my desire is not just to accept the belief, but now to prove to myself whether it's actually real or not, which is actually a shift in my desire from my will. My will is saying accept it, and before my desire was saying, yes, I'm going to accept it. Without any experimentation, any further ideas, concepts, I'm just going to accept it and just live my life like that. That's what my desire was saying before. But now there's my will, still the same as it was before. But my desire is just saying, maybe this is wrong. Maybe I can experiment to find out whether it's wrong. Do you follow? Now my desire has shifted. Now change is possible. Do you follow? Now when we had that written in your outline, if will and desire are in harmony, change is not possible, how many thought that was a typo? Right? Pretty much most of the group last time thought that was a typo. It's not a typo. If the two are in harmony with each other, here's an example, no change is possible. Now, interesting thing. Let's say you become at one with God. And let's say your will is now saying, it's so lovely being at one with God. I'm going to rest up here and not bother having any more desire. Right? So what would that mean? Is your will and desire are in harmony again? And what is that going to mean? No change is possible. So it applies with error as much as it applies with truth. If your will and desire in harmony, no change is actually possible. Interesting. So that means you could actually arrive in a state of at one with God and sit there for many, 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 many years in a stagnant place, because you've yet to develop a desire to think, oh, maybe I could be at one with my soulmate. Maybe that's an opportunity that I can develop for my future. Now, of course, The interesting thing is, you can't actually become at one with God without actually having a desire for your soulmate. So that particular example I gave is probably null and void. But you certainly can have a feeling of, I'm going to stay here because I'm happy now. Right? You could certainly have that and then no longer have a very strong desire. It's very unlikely, though. You could do it, but it's very unlikely. Because by the time you've gotten to the one-man condition, you've had to develop a huge amount of desire to get there. Of course, you're not going to stop now. You've learnt the desire principle. Right? But theoretically, if you're in a state where you had these two the same at any point in your future, no change is going to be possible. Does that make sense to everyone? Now, we haven't even discussed the principles yet, so let's discuss the principles and then answer some of your questions. Now, the beauty of this, so we're still looking at all of these things that we had on this side, so we still might have denial here, right? Still got beliefs here. All of these things that are here belong in this column too, right? And so forth, right? So all of these things still belong. And what we've been saying now is that the desire principle ensures that all laws respond to the desire of the human. So what it's saying is that just like the laws responded to your current condition, the laws actually also have a superseding, this desire principle is actually higher in hierarchy. And desire will also drive what you attract through the law. Interesting, hey? Yep. So, same thing, it ensures all laws satisfy the desire. So not only do the laws satisfy the will, but they also now satisfy the desire, the future, the current faith, which is the future aspired to condition. That's what they're measuring. Now, of course, this applies negatively as well as positively. So if my current condition is not too bad, but I all of a sudden have a desire that is more unloving than my current condition is, where am I going to go? I'm going to change, but in what direction? I'm going to regress. So desire principles give you the chance to control your future state, whether that's regression or progression. Interesting. All right, so of course they still allow, this is what they allow for, the potential for change and growth, development and transformation of the human soul into a divine being with immortality. Can you see that if desire was never measured and our current condition was that, not much chance of anything ever changing from our current condition. But if our desire is now measured, new potentialities become available that weren't available before, because our desire is now being measured. Okay, now you can ask your questions. Rebecca, thank you.
How would you experiment with your current beliefs if your current beliefs are really damaging to others, like superiority?
Yep. So let's say my current will state is I am superior. Right, that's my current will state, is it not? Yep. So I would have to first have an idea or concept that I actually have some faith in. So it needs to be something that I actually believe is possible. Not that I imagine is possible or that I hope is possible, but that I actually feel is possible. Of experimenting whether that's true or not. Experimenting with whether that is true or not. Does that make sense? I need to start there with the experiment. So what experiments can I do? we could try three different experiments, couldn't we? What happens to me when I feel superior and I treat others superior, as if I am superior? What happens to me when I treat others as equal, and what happens to them? And what happens to me and them when I treat others as inferior? I could measure all three states, couldn't I?
How would, if coming from your soul is that you feel superior, how would you truly, genuinely treat others equally?
Well, you could try and engage the experiment of even just physically attempting to treat them as if they're equal, couldn't you?
Yeah.
So in other words, you've got a nice big meal in front of you, someone next to you haven't got much at all, you decide, I'm going to share this and see what happens. Does that make sense? As a part of this experiment. Experimentation is a lovely way to prove facts, right? Scientifically. You could do that. Or you could even have faith that, no, you could go further, couldn't you? You could say, I want to treat people equal. And ask yourself, what are all of my feelings inside of me that cause me to not treat people equal? And then I have to develop faith on every one of those feelings to actually change that condition. Does that make sense? So that might take the form of something like this. I see that when I'm with people, I want them to meet my addictions. That's what I want. And why do I want that though? See, as soon as I ask the question why, my desire has shifted. Because before you weren't asking why. Right? And it's very similar to what's happened with you in this course, actually, Rebecca. Considering right at the beginning of the course, my feelings were to remove Rebecca. And the only reason why you didn't get removed was because you're new to divine truth, right? And yet you have engaged your questioning process of asking why, what's the problem here, what does it do, what's happening in my relationship with Nikki, what's happening, you know, and you've asked that question. You follow me? So this is a wonderful example. Just asking the question has caused you to have a shift in attitude. You remember at the beginning of the group, you were sitting right up the back in the corner, not engaging. The man you were sitting next to, he was going to sleep. That's how much oppression he was getting in the process, right? Right next to you. And I'm going, Nikki, I know Nikki. He's never gone to sleep before when he's, when he's hearing divine truth, and he's asleep. So what's going on here? Right? Now, obviously, if you're sensitive emotionally, you can feel what's going on. But you changed that. How did you change that? By actually going, oh, maybe what people are telling me is different to what I currently believe. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to make you cry, but it's a fantastic example of what you've done. You actually developed a desire to actually see, to get out of where you were, which was complete denial about what you were doing, right? So your desire on the issue of denial has significantly shifted, right? So what I would suggest you do now is you go back and ask yourself, why did my desire on denial shift? What caused me to shift? Now, can you see it wasn't just somebody else telling you, because I've told heaps of other people for years and years the same thing, and it's made no difference to their life whatsoever. Do you see? So it's not somebody telling you that made you shift. There's got to have been something that happened inside of you that caused you to shift. You follow? And that's a great example of there's been a shift on the desire to remain in denial. So what caused you to shift from that desire? Can you see that at this stage you haven't even thought about it? You've just sort of done it without much thinking. Can you see that? You haven't really thought about what was the underlying shift that occurred. But you could spend some time on that and find out what it was. Because you want to repeat that. Does that make sense? You want to repeat that with any other things that are there. Makes
Thank
sense?
You.
Yeah, it's good. If we go to Adrian in front of you, thanks.
So if there is no desire at all and willpower doesn't work, when I'm about to sin, what if I don't have a desire, then I'm better off sinning than using willpower to stop myself?
No, you're definitely not better off sinning, but at the end of the day, you're going to.
But I can, if there is no desire, I could use my willpower to stop myself from...
Yeah, but you're still sinning because you're trying to use willpower and not desire. Remember, that sins against the responsibility principle, and so that's every law. You're sinning. So you're still sinning. The attitude is still the same, and the attitude's not changing. Remember, God's law is measured to the attitude. That's got to change. So using willpower just masks the attitude. So what's better? Isn't it better to acknowledge the attitude, or... is it better to mask it over and cover it over and make out it's not there? Isn't it better to acknowledge rather than to cover it over? Certainly. So you can see that just even using willpower is a desire to mask over or cover over the actual attitude, which doesn't help you at all. You'd be better off going, hang on a sec, I really feel like sinning. And asking the magic question, the magic three-letter word, what? Why? Why do I? Just asking that has now created a desire, interestingly. Isn't that fascinating? Having a sincere desire to know why, basically in that moment starts shifting your desire, right? That's all you need to start with doing. Asking yourself, why do I want to sin here? Why do I want to go to bed with that woman for? I don't know if she's my soulmate or not. Why am I choosing to do that? It's got to be a reason. Just asking why is going to cause you to pause and actually probably not take the action, possibly. You're going to still feel like taking the action, but the desire is saying, no, hang on a sec, I want to know why I want to take this action all the time. Because otherwise I finish up sleeping with woman after woman after woman after woman after woman. I don't know what I'm doing to my soulmate relationship here, but I'm certainly destroying my relationship with God. I've got to know why I'm doing this. That is a desire for self-awareness about the issue. As soon as the desire for self-awareness is gone, now I've got self-responsibility on that issue. I now want to be aware. There's a higher, because this desire now engages higher principles, it's now going to, I'm going to get feedback about why, what it is. What do I feel when I don't go to bed with her? What do I feel? Is it just that you feel like you're missing out, or is it just feel like I need something from her to validate me? Or what is it that you feel? Because you start feeling that now that you've had a desire to ask why. But if you don't have a desire to ask why, you won't know, you see? So can you see it's like all we need to start with is that, and straight away desire has shifted, right? As soon as desire shifts away from will, now we have a chance. We have a chance to change. Before then, we didn't have a chance to change. Before then, we just go, yep, opportunity arrives. Yep, I'm doing it. Yep, and it's automatic. Yep, opportunity arrives. Yes, I do that. Opportunity arrives to steal. Yeah, I do that. Opportunity arrives to have sex with anybody. Yes, I do that. Opportunity arises to, you know, to, I don't know, you could list anything, couldn't you? Opportunity arises to get any addiction met. You're just going to go ahead and do it unless... you're asking yourself, why am I doing this? As soon as I ask why, my desire shifts. As soon as my desire shifts, I have a chance to change. Before then, no chance of change. And this is the reason why most people on earth, while they're on earth, don't change. Because they never ask why about anything. They just go ahead and do it. And particularly when it comes to emotions and feelings and impulses, they never ask why. Why they have them. They never even ask whether it's possible to change them. So they don't change them. Yeah. Make sense, Adrian?
Thank you.
Yeah. If we go to Eloisa on this side.
I have a question about nurturing desires. So when you have a desire and then like you ask why and then good things start to happen, How do you keep doing that so that they continue rather than stagnate on the good bit?
Well, remember the law of attraction is operating on both conditions, is it not?
Correct.
So the law of attraction is still going to bring you the negative condition until such a time as that condition actually has changed emotionally.
Yes.
Okay. So one great thing to work on is, why am I resisting emotion? You've learnt already that while an emotion exists inside of the soul, it determines your will. It's preclusion. It stops you from change while that emotion exists. All I need to do is develop a desire to know why I don't want to feel emotion.
Awesome. Yep.
Then I have a chance of changing. Does that make sense?
It does.
And then you'll see, if you allow yourself to be sensitive to that, which is another desire that you'll have to also develop, you might start feeling some of the emotional reasons why you are afraid of emotions.
Yes.
You know, and the law of attraction will bring you them because your desire is more powerful than your will. So your law of attraction will bring you events that help you see why you're so scared of emotion.
Awesome.
You go, and so that, let's say you stand up for yourself and you just get hammered. Oh, that's the reason why. Oh, I'm afraid of getting hammered every time. You actually deal with the fear of getting hammered, then you'll start telling the truth to people and you don't get hammered. Because now it's all, my will has changed from saying I'm afraid of getting hammered to being not afraid of getting hammered anymore. Ironically, I'll get less hammered, right? Because the law of attraction is operating upon my will beforehand, I'm going to get hammered quite frequently. But now that my will has changed, I'll get less hammered. I speak the truth and I get less hammered. And I get to the point where I speak the truth and nobody hardly hammers you at all. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So just to clarify, so what you're saying is that my will right now, okay, it's all of this stuff and I'm attracting all... a lot of it's not very nice.
Yep.
But as soon as my desire goes and I emotionally deal with the current will,
yep,
then my will actually has changed.
Yeah, but you've even got to have a desire to let go of the emotion, don't
Correct.
You?
I do.
And most people that I've met still listening to Divine Truth don't.
Yep,
me too. Right? So that's why things don't change, because there's no desire to ask the question, why am I so afraid of emotion? Remember in the second group, We ask the question why all the time. Yeah. You remember that?
Yes.
Why am I like this? Why am I like that? The reason why we ask that question is because we're trying to encourage your desire.
Yeah.
Because we know that if we encourage your desire, you have a possibility of shifting from your current will-based condition.
Yeah.
Right? But without the question why, you're not going to.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So rather than trying to force yourself to be different, you've got to ask, why do I want to stay the same? Can you see that? So trying to force yourself to be different is almost an impossible thing, because that's willpowering over what's actually inside of you, which is why you want to be the same as you currently are. You are what you are because you want to be what you are. That makes sense to you? Right? And the only reason why that's not changing is because there's no desire to want to be something different on those issues.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only reason why it's not changing. When I want to be something different and I actually have faith that that is possible, and I actually do some experiments and ask why, now I have the chance to change. I didn't have that chance before, but now I have. Right? And this is what I see many of you just living in this space where you just do the same thing over and over again, same situation, same thing, same situation, same thing, same situation, same thing. Imagine if you had a song that in your head 24/7 and it was just going da 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 da. You know, after one day you'd be driven out of your mind. But this is what you're doing with your life. You're engaging the same thing, the same way, the same thing, the same way, the same thing, the same way. No desire to ask why. Same thing, the same way. Do you see what I'm saying?
I do.
And because you're engaging the same thing, the same way, every time, you've got no chance of change. Right? You've got to stop at some point and ask yourself why. If you don't, you'll just not change. You'll stay forever in that place. Now, as we learnt in our foundation principles, God created the development principle, which basically forces everything to change. Sooner or later, you're going to respond to those principles in law, right? Sooner or later. But I'm saying to you, no, here's the faster way of doing it. Rather than getting forced into the whole process, wouldn't it be better to engage this thing called desire and actually do the process because you want to? Remember, the will gets corrected. If we looked at the will principles, and the will gets corrected by forcing you to get to the stage where there's so much emotion in you, so much baggage in you, that you just burst. But the trouble is, most of us don't burst, we just dribble and release the pressure. It's like a pressure valve. You know those old crock pots where you just put it on the stove. You know, I don't know if you've any of you have done this. You put it on the stove and you forget to release the pressure valve, or the pressure valve gets stuck. Eventually the whole thing blows up, right? It just boom, you know, wrecks the place. And this is what many of us are like. Many of us are like that. We just feel like, oh, as long as I just let a little bit of pressure off, I'll not blow up. And really what you need to do is just have a blow up and just get to the stage where that's what I'm like right now, this is what I am. And do I want to know why? You see?
Yes, yeah? Thank you. Yeah? That's awesome. And that's why the emotion is so important, as you've been saying, because quite frankly, without doing it, there's no change.
Well, the emotion's very important, but even more important is asking myself why I don't want to feel it.
Yes.
Because asking why, I've got a potential to shift from denying it, shutting it down, pushing it down, suppressing it, to a different place where I now start to allow it. Right?
Got it.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Nikki, you'd like to?
I guess that's kind of why prayer is so important, because it's like you're finally exercising the desire to know all these things, and I guess like... prayer is that desire to God, isn't it, to get responses from God.
Mm-hmm.
And so God can bring you things so much quicker than
yes.
you would have in a forced condition.
Yes.
And so you've got more of a chance to change quicker.
Yeah, let's look at prayer, shall we? Because it's quite important to look at. I don't know if I've got it here somewhere. I think I have. Let me just find it. Oh, no, I mentioned it in the will, didn't I? Sorry, I skipped over it in the will. So what I'll do is I'll just go back to the will principles and play that and go to the prayer section, because it's an interesting example, right? Maybe I haven't got them in the... I've got them in your outline, haven't I? Which one have I got? Oh, I've got it in redemption and transformation, haven't I? Sorry, I'm getting too well versed with my own information. Let's switch back and just go through the redemption principles. Actually, so we'll do the redemption principles, just to give you some idea of the difference between desire and will. So here's will. Redemption principles can be engaged with desire by making a choice to emotionally engage forgiveness and repentance with faith. Right. They can be engaged with God by sincerely desiring God's love and forgiveness. But they can be engaged also with will. They operate automatically with will by causing the creation of pain when we sin and the release of pain when pain becomes too intense. So what happens with will is that God has a whole heap of laws that respond to your will. And what happens is the pressure cooker up, right? We get more and more intense pain, till you get to the stage where your pain threshold, your emotional pain threshold, is exceeded. Now you just spurt open, don't you? Until the emotional pain threshold is low enough for you to cope again. Well, that's an example of redemption using will. Will is operating on your current condition, and eventually it's going to force you to have a pressure cooker explosion. But it's not you having desire to do it. You just feel like you've got to do it, because if you don't, you're just going to burst. So you do it. That's an example of redemption through will. Redemption through desire is different. Because redemption through desire says, hang on a sec, am I going to wait until the pressure cooker is almost exploding? Or am I going to start addressing these problems one by one now? That's what desire does. Why do I have this resistance to dealing with my emotion? Now my desire shifts. I start looking at why. I start trying to address the issue. Does that make sense? Mm. Now I've got some hope to actually change that condition. Now, can you see that will-based changes, which are still possible, by the way, by having this forced upon you, right? That's how God redeems you, with your will only. Like, pretty much every person who ever passed from earth are in that state in the hells. And what I mean is they have no desire to know why. They have no desire to work out any of those things. All they have is a great big long list of all their sins that they eventually have to redeem. They don't even ask why this list is in front of them, the majority of them. They just feel forced. The next one comes up and they feel forced to have to have some emotions about it. The first emotion generally is anger. And then they go into some fear generally. And then they eventually get to the stage that, oh, they want certain things met, and they have a big cry about the fact that those things are not getting met. And this happens naturally because God's laws are operating upon their current will condition. None of it's driven by their desire, right? But they're still changing because it's driven by the fact that God's laws operate upon the will, trying to correct the will from its current state. But a person with desire goes, why have I got this list in front of me? What's going on with this list in front of me? Why does this list exist? What's going on? And he tries to get some kind of answers to these questions. Now, as soon as he exercises even the desire to know the answer to the questions, spirits come to him, who are assigned by God, by the way, to come to him and explain to him why the list exists and what's going on and what he needs to do about it and the two ways that he can deal with it. Can you see the difference?
Yeah.
One way, he's going to go through a long, drawn-out, maybe thousands of year process of just getting hammered by each sin until he no longer remembers it emotionally. The other is that he's got some desire to know why it's all happening and therefore engage some higher laws. That's his choice. That's your choice too, by the way, if you think about it. For the majority of you at the moment, you're just getting hammered by what you don't want to know. Right, and this lets you ask why. Now you want to know. Now you've got some chance of actually changing things more rapidly. Does everyone get that? The difference between those two states.
Yep.
So the redemption principles is a great way of, you know, seeing these differences between desire and the operation of desire and will and the operation of will. So we're not saying that you won't change eventually if you only have will. We're not saying that, because the reality is the laws operate upon your will, correcting your will. They do. But it's going to be a long, drawn-out, painful experience. That's what it's going to be, guaranteed. Long, drawn-out, painful experience. With desire, a whole different set of laws are now engaged. Now we have the chance for it to not be a long, drawn-out, painful experience, but rather a much shorter experience driven by the fact that we now want to know why while it's happening. We want to correct things while they're occurring. Now we have a chance of changing much more rapidly. Now the same applies in the sixth dimension of the spirit world. A spirit in the sixth dimension has exercised their will to be self-reliant and work through some of, when I say exercise their will has been forced through the law for them to have these pressure cooker releases that eventually occur because they get too much pain, and they eventually release one more thing and they release another thing, and sometimes some awareness now grows, of course, as a result of these releases that occur. Now there's a smidge of desire being developed, and so they start developing desire to do it more rapidly, and eventually they get to the sixth dimension of the spirit world, but they still have no desire for God. They still have a desire to be a self-reliant being. So they get to the sixth dimension of the spirit world, and what do they do? Well, there's no desire driving them beyond that point. So the will is now going to be worked upon. And what's the will? The will out of harmony with love, with God's love, is such that there is a sin called the sin against the Holy Spirit, and there's penalties for that sin. And one of the penalties for the sin is a feeling of personal worry and concern. And what they get worried and concerned about is this issue of whether they're ever going to die or not, because they still don't know whether they were immortal or not. And so now they create educational institutions. And in fact, most of the universities in the sixth sphere are dedicated towards one particular subject. How to scientifically achieve immortality. That's the subject. And as you can imagine, immortality is quite a complex issue, being one of the highest of God's laws for the highest of God's creation. So it's going to be many, many millennia before they might even find out scientifically how to do it. But even then, they won't be able to do it because it requires the issue of connecting with God to do it, you see. And they stay in that state. So what's causing them now? Now they're generating some desire to know why. Why am I in this state? Can you see now they have a desire? There's a chance to change. Right? So what happens there is many celestial spirits come along and say, look, you've got to understand this thing about receiving God's love. You're just talking about the same crap again, you know, like the same, you know, Christian thing from earth, you know, go away. I'm going to stay in my university and work it out the right way, you know. That's what they feel. And then of course, they stay in university another few years, usually it's another 100 or more. And then another spirit comes along and says, you still got a desire and you still haven't found out why. And I'm telling you why, right? And they go, no, it all just sounds like too much, you know, like it's all this religious crap you're trying to tell me. No, they're like, no, you know, I'm going to find out from a scientific way. So they go on another 100 years or two. But they still have a desire. But each 100 years or two that passes, because they're not progressing, their desire starts becoming quite annoying. Can you see that? It's like you'll almost try anything, isn't it? It's like having a sickness or a disease on earth where the pain gets too great. You'll almost try anything to fix it, won't you? And it's the same for them. So they get to a point where they go, the next time somebody comes along and says, talks about God's love again and talks about desire again, and what do they do this time? They go, okay, you know, like, I'll give it a go. like, how do I give it a go? Well, that usually is another 50-year discussion because there's got to overcome quite a lot of resistance in order for that to occur. But at least now their desire has led them into this new place where they want to know. Does that make sense? So that's how many six-sphere spirits get out of the six-sphere. So they're in a perfectly happy state, what they believe is a perfectly happy state. And without that will-based beginning, where their will is get this annoyance of immortality, which is God's laws operating upon the will, triggering them into a state of wanting to know the answer, which is now a desire to know why, which they then engage, now they have a chance to change. Make sense? So it applies to every level of your existence. Hell, sixth sphere, celestial spirit, doesn't matter. Can you see the importance of it? Because when you think about it, the will-based laws really only really operate until the at-one-ment condition in a lot of ways. They're still operating, of course, but it's like they don't exist anymore because your heart is now in line with God's love completely, so it's not like those laws don't exist anymore. Nothing's operating upon your will very much anymore. It's operating upon your desire. Change is going to happen because of engaging desire. This is why desire is such an important thing to understand, because without it, change is impossible. Does everyone get that? Yeah. Fascinating, hey? Lani, thank you.
Can you apply that with like governance, like wanting to, a desire to stop giving governance away?
Of course. You can apply desire. The beauty of desire is that you can apply it to absolutely everything that you ever experience, physical, emotional, spiritual, doesn't matter what category, what area of life, doesn't matter about whether it's music, art, whatever, it's all the same. It all responds to desire. At the end of the day, can you see that if, let's look at it from a physical perspective. Let's say you don't know Spanish and you decide that you want to speak Spanish. What's now gone in to the mix?
Desire.
Right? Of course, you probably, now if the desire is great enough, what will happen? You need to use a mic if you're going to talk money.
Yeah, you'll take action and go ahead and find out about it.
You will, and you'll eventually speak Spanish, won't you?
Yes.
If your desire is strong enough.
Yes.
If your desire is not strong enough, what will happen?
Well, you won't.
You'll just give it up, won't you?
So it's like that with desiring not to give your governance away. It needs to be strong enough so that you'll keep experimenting and keep...
Yes, and let's say it's not strong enough. Surely you could just ask yourself?
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
Now I have a chance to change it from being weak desire to a strong desire. Why don't I have a strong desire? Now, the question, why don't I have a strong desire, is a very interesting question, actually. Because usually what it does is exposes a whole heap of fears you didn't know you had. Yes. Right? So for that reason, it's a very good question to ask all the time. Why don't I have a strong desire? I just don't feel like doing it. Like when it comes to basic thing like, say, eating meat, not eating meat. Right? Those of you who still eat meat occasionally, you don't have a desire yet. Right? The question becomes why? What does meat give you, emotionally give you, that causes you to remain in the condition of eating it? What is it that you're not seeing in the world around you of the damage that it does? What is that? What is the belief system medically? Because many of you just have a medical reason why you keep doing it and you're not looking at what the belief system is there. Many of you also have a family reason why you do it. You know, if I started not eating meat, my family would just criticize me. There's another example there. But can you see, to change any of those things, you need to ask why. You need to know why. But the interesting thing, as soon as you start asking why, God starts trying to show you why. Because the law responds more to desire than it does to your current condition. So he's trying to now show you why. And so if you're very observant, and a lot of times you don't have to be very observant, it's just like bang in your face, but if you're very observant or very humble, you'll be asking that question all the time and seeing what God's laws are reflecting back at you all the time, and you'll make some quite significant changes in your life as a result. Yeah.
Yes, make sense? Thank you.
Yeah. Kate, you had your hand up? We've got only time for your question.
It's sort of a clarifying...
Sure. Yeah.
Well, I've been curious for a while about the 14. Like, I just thought it's really interesting that many... Like, they were people you knew in the first time round.
Yeah.
And,
Can you see what their problem is?
Problem?
Yeah. All the 14 that are not engaged with what any of the memories that they have or any of those things, suppressing all of those things. Mm. See, just incarnating caused a condition of no memories of past experiences, no memories of their previous life and so forth. That's what incarnation caused as a condition, right? But what is the problem? The problem is they don't have any desire to address that. They don't have any desire to experiment with that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And while that remains, where are they going to be? Exactly the same place they are now. Make sense to you? So it applies to any person. It doesn't matter who you are, right? This is the beauty of God's laws, isn't it? And God's principles, they apply to everyone equally, right? So it applies to every person. So yes, most of the 14 at this stage are in a state where they have no desire at all. Many of them, in fact, have a desire to sin. And so they are degrading their condition. And they have a desire to sin primarily because they want to ignore some very big emotions. And they want to ignore some very big attitudes and particularly ignore some very big memories and experiences. They're sort of like people with Alzheimer's disease in a lot of ways, who are doing basically exactly the same thing, are they not? They're shutting down memories they could have and turning themselves into a state where they can't remember anything. Oh, and that's really what many of the 14 are doing. You follow? Turning themselves into a state where they can't remember anything. And it's driven by a lot of fear and a lot of other emotions that they are not having a desire to address. Make sense?
Yep.
Yeah. Now, if you ask Mary, it's taken her many years to develop a desire to address some of those emotions. It took me many years to develop a desire to address many of those emotions. I only started addressing my emotions when I was 34 years of age. Right? And the main reason why is because I had a very severe belief before then that I was going to die when I was 34, and I didn't. And I'm going, I'm not dead now. Maybe I better do something about where I'm at. You follow me? And that was one of the main things that caused me to ask, why did I have this feeling that I'm going to die when I'm 34? Because I always had it my whole life. So can you see, even for them, the principle applies. It's no different. Yeah, so don't think that they're exempt in any way from the law, from the principle. They're not. Make sense to you? Of course, that raises a whole lot of other questions, doesn't it? So what we're going to do is we'll have our lunch break now, and we'll, when we come back, I think I've allowed 50 minutes as a Q&A on the subject. And as a result of this discussion, you may find some of you have got some additional questions. And if that's the case, I think Mary has left two or so sheets there up the back for Human Will and Desire that you can write your questions down. And when we come back, I'll just select those questions, and away we'll go and try to answer as many of your questions as possible about desire and will that we can. Thanks, guys. Thank you.